It is October 22nd, 2015. We are here on the campus of University of Georgia in Athens, Georgia. We're here with Mr. Art Rosenbaum, recording an oral history with him. My name is David Heinsen, and I'm joined by...
Kevin Green.
Great. And we're so happy you can join us today, Art.
Well, I'm very happy as well to be here.
Great. We're going to start today with just kind of filling in the biographical gaps from your previous oral interviews, and then we'll start talking about the Athens music scene and such. All right. Okay. So to start with today, can you please tell us where you grew up, something about your siblings and your parents?
Well, I grew up a lot of places. I was born in Ogdensburg, New York in 1938, way up on the St. Lawrence River. My father was a pathologist. And that was his first job out of his residency and after I was born, but I left there when I was too young to remember anything about Ogdensburg. Well, since I mentioned my father, he was from Paterson, New Jersey, and he was a pathologist. Spent most of his professional years at after World War II, in which he was an Army doc in Indianapolis at the VA hospital there. So that's where I grew up from the third grade through high school when I went away to college. But before the third grade, I lived a number of places, including Augusta, Georgia, Hattiesburg, Mississippi, when my father was stationed there during World War II, and New Jersey, and a lot of places. So it was a kind of a lot of traveling being an Army brat. My mother was from New York City, and she was a medical technologist and an artist, and kind of got me going in that path. Mm-hmm. I went to Columbia University, Columbia College for my undergraduate work, and got my MFA also at Columbia in the early 1960s. Trying to think if that answers the basic questions.
Yeah.
I'm siblings. Yeah, I have a brother, younger brother, Victor, who's a classical pianist. Concertizes a lot and teaches at the Mannes School of Music in New York and also at the New England Conservatory, which y'all are interested in being music students and teachers. And also I have a younger sister who lives on the West Coast.
What was the importance of music in your household growing up?
It was very important on many levels. There was a lot of music. My earliest memories are listening to 78 RPM records, not the classic 78 RPM records for the most part that I became interested in later that kind of were so important in the kind of music I'm interested in, which is the early traditional music, but it was, some of it was folk music. There was Tony Kraber, who was a left-wing New York guy who had spent time in the cattle camps in the West, and he did a very authentic recording of in an album of cowboy songs. There was the Talking Union, which was the Almanac Singers. Pete Seeger was in that group, and Millard Lampel and Lee Hayes and other people. They did early labor songs, so listen to that kind of record. Also, there was classical music because my parents were interested in classical music, and of course, I gave my brother his impetus to go into classical music. Our musical interests diverged, and besides that, my mother played the piano a little bit, and my father played the mandolin, and his brother, my uncle Sam Rosenbaum, also played the mandolin. He was much better than my father, and they came from the era when. I guess it would have been in the 1920s, when kind of working class kids would take mandolin lessons and sometimes be in these little mandolin ensembles. And so my father played a couple of tunes, Russian folk tunes and whatever, but my uncle could play anything he heard. So when he was visiting or when we were visiting him, I heard that kind of music and classical music. And beyond that, my father also sang some songs, some street songs he learned as a kid in Paterson, New Jersey. When you'd hang out on the stoops or under the lamppost in the evenings, you'd sing these songs. Sometimes they were like parodies of pop songs, sometimes they'd be folk songs, sometimes they'd be slightly bawdy songs. She jumped in bed and covered up her head and saw, could not find her, but I knew damn well she lied like hell, so I jumped right in behind her. And if you know folk music, that's an Irish, an Irish-American tune, The Girl I Left Behind Me, also turned into a cowboy song, and a lot of different sets of words. And here's a Jewish kid in Paterson, New Jersey, parents born in shtetls of Eastern Europe, who emigrated to this country, singing an American, singing a verse of an Irish-American song, and several others like that, and other kinds of street songs. Those were the and sort of some nonsense songs, just for entertainment. And so I early on got the idea that songs and ditties did not have to be anything serious or anything commercial, but they could be just something that you'd hear in the family. I also, when I was visiting my grandmother in Paterson, New Jersey, she would sing some Yiddish songs, some Yiddish folk songs. So maybe that was that and the 78 RPM record albums that I was mentioning a minute ago were part of that musical environment that set me on a direction that I went in, you know, quest for like homemade music or traditional music or vernacular music. I'm avoiding the word folk because that's such a catch-all. It's almost as bad as roots music as having lost most of its original meaning. Who knows what is roots music? Anyway, I'm getting off the subject, or maybe I'm not.
No, that's all right. when did you first start playing musical instruments, and what instruments did you begin with?
I started with guitar around 1950, when I was 11 years old. Like, I think I just started learning a couple of chords. I knew I wanted to play some kind of folk-type instrument, and so I got a cheap Stella guitar and learned a few chords. And later, I had a guitar teacher, a guy named Amos Arthur in Indianapolis, who was a regular guitar teacher. He showed me a little bit of reading music and some jazz chords, which I don't really play anymore. And he also he was a good teacher to give me a little bit of a foundation, but the guitar, I guess, was my first instrument. I did give a stab at the cello. That lasted 1 week. My parents rented a cello. Would I like to take cello lessons? And I said, well, I don't think I'm going to go for the cello. I like it when cellists play. So that was my first instrument was guitar, and I just mainly to accompany songs that I like to sing, and later I got a little more into finger picking and other styles. Then when I was in high school, I started the five-string banjo, which is my maybe favorite lifetime instrument. On the recording that I mentioned a few minutes ago, the Talking Union, labor song sung by the Almanac Singers, Pete Seeger was playing a five-string banjo, and he was really the first of the urban people to really go back into the folk banjo, and he learned it from people like Bascomah Mar Lunsford in North Carolina, Samantha Bumgarner, who he heard at the Asheville Festival when he was a teenager. His father, the musicologist Charles Seeger, understood something about traditional music and took young Pete to hear the festival, and I guess he got hung up on hearing Aunt Samantha Bumgarner playing Worried Blues or one of those old tunes, and he started playing the first licks on the banjo, and then as a young guy in the Almanac Singer Circle in New York, he would play the banjo on picket lines and for rallies and recording. So I really like that sound, the bump diddy, it was up picking, bump diddy, bump diddy. That is a great sound. You know, there were guitars playing the rhythm, but so I had to learn the banjo. Then at the same time, I was starting to listen to some of the earlier recordings of the rural music, mostly of the South, that were becoming available, like the Harry Smith anthology, I should mention, you know, which came out in the 50s, and that was on folkways, and it was a 3-volume, 2 LP each set of reissues from Harry Smith's collection of old 78s, and it had roots music, shall we say, although I deplored the term a minute ago, but it had people like, well, it would take all our session to go down the list, but the Carter Family, Blind Lemon Jefferson, Mississippi John Hurt, Uncle Dave Macon, Doc Boggs, Bascom Lamar Lunsford, the Stoneman Family, Poppin' Ma Stoneman, the early people who recorded for what was originally called the Hillbilly and the Race catalogs. Hillbilly being Southern white music and race, although that's a term that we kind of deplore these days. That was for the African American market of gospel and blues. And Harry Smith had a collection. He put it together in his selections in a very idiosyncratic manner, but it was mind blowing to hear those recordings because that seemed to come from a very authentic mm-hmm. place. Not weird, Greil Marcus wrote this essay, the old Weird America, sort of referring to that collection and as if these are these strange lost voices from, I don't want to kind of give short shrift to his total argument, but I just found them wonderful and not mysterious, but kind of deep and compelling and just interesting, a lot of other people were discovering them too, the Grateful Dead and the New Lost City Ramblers and all. So I was listening to the banjo on that collection, which was played either as a accompaniment to a solo voice or in a kind of string band, and so I learned from that as well. And then when I was in high school, I found out that Pete Seeger had put together a book, How to Play the 5-String Banjo, and I ordered that, and that gave me the rudiments of these different styles, and so I worked at that in my bedroom, closed the door, and worked it out. It was a year before I even met another person and heard another person in person playing a 5-string banjo. By that time, I'd acquired a little proficiency. Later on, I took up the fiddle and harmonica and some other instruments, but you asked about the first instrument. I had to bring the banjo in.
Yeah.
My first banjo was a Stadium brand banjo. We had a neighbor, Charlie Bassler, who had a little pawn shop down in downtown Indianapolis, so I went and got the... I won a $25 first prize for a painting at the Indiana State Fair in the junior student division, and I took that $25 and bought this Stadium banjo, which was just a rudimentary beginner banjo. Nowadays, there are rudimentary beginner banjos that are a lot better than that. That one I could not really tune up when I had to raise one string, like a 1 fret or a half tone higher, but it was good enough to get me started. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So speaking of your art prize, when did you first become interested in painting and murals?
Well, murals were later, but I was making art was maybe my first interest from the time I was a little kid. I mentioned before that my mother was an artist, studied at the National Academy of Design, and actually studied medical illustration and did a little medical illustration in her early years. So. As a little tiny tot, I was interested, like a lot of kids are interested in drawing, but my mother encouraged that interest. So I started really, really young, and so that was my main interest. And worked kind of as an independent artist when I was high school age. I took classes. But already I'd seen, my uncle had a collection of 20th century German art that he had acquired after World War II when he was over there and in Europe. And so I grew up looking at artists like Katie Kollwitz and Max Beckmann, original prints and a few painting, so, and was taken to museums, and so I was interested in serious art. You know, I don't want to the tradition of I could say beginning with European painting and looking at people like Van Gogh and Picasso and Max Beckmann and people who became my idols from a young age. So when I say when I wasn't just getting interested through high school classes or through pop illustrations and comics, although that's a great way to do it. I was already interested in museum type art and trying to do it. I was painting in oils from when I was maybe in the third grade or so, and working a lot on my own. I had a real good teacher in high school, Elizabeth Hauck, and she died just a few years ago, and a reporter from the Indianapolis newspaper called and somehow got my name as a former student and asked, for some reminiscences of her, the impact of her teaching. And I was kind of tongue-tied. I couldn't really think of the kind of little bullet remark that the reporter was interested in. I tried to say some good things as I remembered them. But later, I sort of thought about it and pondered, and I thought, well, what I really said was I kind of got an almost unspoken message from her that I should just go ahead and do it, that she had enough respect to not, try to say do it this way or do it that way, but that she respected that I had a serious commitment to what I was doing and was on my way somewhere. And that kind of teacher can be good. I would expand from that, into other teachers. Nowadays students have to grade their teachers and write out that was unheard of. Not, I'm talking about college and graduate school, not high school. But some teachers that you might say, well, I can't remember exactly what disciplines I learned from that teacher, but sometimes you might just learn from what's unspoken or assumed or just or example. But so I decided that's what I want to study, and I was doing oil paintings. I would get into juried shows and Indiana Artists Exhibit when I was in high school. So I was pretty serious about it. When I went to college, I didn't go to art school. Columbia College did not have a studio degree. There was a studio program at Columbia University. Now they have School of the Arts, which has expanded into a lot of disciplines. But I guess, and my parents thought I should have a liberal arts education, even though I was really headed toward wanting to be a visual artist. So I got into a really good liberal arts program at Columbia and took some studio classes and did a lot of work on my own. They offered some courses as electives. And then, but my major was art history. It was an academic major. Then I went from there right into the graduate program at Columbia, the MFA program, with rather fewer studio hours than would be considered appropriate today, but I had a lot of independent experience and a few good courses, plus the faculty knew me and thought I could do it. So I did MFA also at Columbia.
What were you doing musically during your time at Columbia?
Well, I jumped right into the folk music milieu, because in Indianapolis there were maybe a couple people. There was a slightly older friend whom I saw just last month in Maryland, Ted Watts, who had a collection of old blues recordings. Actually, he had some old 78s, was interested in blues, but actually there weren't other people I played music with who played the type of music that I played. I was in a Unitarian youth group, and they sort of wanted a junior Pete Seeger to sing fun labor songs or whatever. So there wasn't really a musical milieu. But when I went to New York, met a fellow student, Roger Lass, who was a good finger picker on guitar and played banjo, and then started meeting other people. Happy Traum, who's still active in music, who was a finger picker, and other people. Seen down in Greenwich Village and the folk revival. So, and then there were several classmates of mine. Tam Gibbs was I'll talk about Tam for a minute. He was in the class of 60 at Columbia. He's from Berkeley, California, and he played Mississippi blues. And he'd learned from Casey Douglas, who was from Mississippi and who'd been one of the proteges of Tommy Johnson, who was one of the great early blues recording artists. Later in Indianapolis, I met a man named Shirley Griffith, who was also a protege of Tommy Johnson, who played a lot of the same repertoire. But Tam played Canned Heat Blues and Big Road Blues, and he'd learned from this African-American blues player from Mississippi who'd moved to the Bay Area. And so here, it was secondhand, but it was firsthand, if you understand what I'm saying. It was music that had gone from, Mississippi to California to this young high school guy who somehow got the bug to want to play blues the way I got the bug to want to play the banjo. Then there was another friend, Steve Cogan, who just passed away this last year, who played mandolin. He was a New York guy who was interested in that music. Jeff Stewart played guitar. He was also from New York, and we eventually formed a little group called the Columbia Chambery Players. Chambery, apostrophe, Y, because mm-hmm. we played chambery music, because we were a string ensemble. And I had a roommate, Brooks Otis, who is still continuing an interest in string music, guitar music, through the present time. So there were other enthusiasts. I went to the Swarthmore Folk Festival during my undergraduate years, and there were older people like John Jacob Niles, who records I'd heard. He was a man from Kentucky who collected mountain ballads and sang them in a kind of idiosyncratic style, but there he was. Peggy Seeger was there, and I'd heard a couple of her records. She was a sister of Mike Seeger, who later became a good friend, and they were both kids of Charles Seeger and Ruth Crawford Seeger. She was there. I heard her records, and she was there in person. Tom Paley, who's living in London now, who's one of the original New Law City Ramblers, and I heard a little LP that he put out, one of the first introductions I had to that kind of music, played by someone who grew up in the city but had learned about the music. So they were all there, and then later I went to the Yale Hoot, went up to New Haven, and they had people who were interested in that music. So it was really kind of a heady atmosphere. If you were in that direction, you could find a lot of people who were interested in Southern American music of various kinds, and not hesitant to attempt to play it. There were other types of music that developed in the folk revival. There were the pop folk groups, like the Kingston Trio and Peter, Paul, and Mary. But by the time they came on the scene, and they were the beginning of some people's interest who later gravitated toward the more traditional. But by the time they came on the scene, my musical direction had already been formed, and I had very little interest in that kind of popularization of folk music. It was part of the larger picture. But that was pretty much what was going on during those years. And when I was a senior at Columbia College, I was invited to do a radio program. And I called it Key to the Highway, or Keys to the Highway, which is an old blues song that Tam Gibbs played. Later I found a lot of the early people like Big Bill Brinsey played. I'm trying to think, I can't think right now who did the first recording of it. So I used it as a theme song, but I played recordings of the kind of music I was interested in. Sometimes I'd get friends into the studio to play live. Did an interview with Jean Ritchie, who also just passed away earlier this year. She in her 90s, and she was very important in the New York folk music scene. She was from Viper, Kentucky, in Perry County, and she got a master's degree, I believe, in social work, and moved up to New York with her dulcimer and her store of songs, which were, you know, a couple hundred old songs that she learned in her family's circle. So she was very influential, a great traditional singer, and wrote some interesting books on growing up with the traditional music, and had a Fulbright to find in the British Isles to find the counterparts of and predecessors of her family repertoire in Ireland and England and Scotland. So I did an interview with her, got to know her, did an interview with Alan Lomax and a couple other people. So that was interesting, to kind of get into radio and in a campus radio station, and did what I wanted to do. So that was kind of my music interest during those years. Well, let me say that's when I started also doing field work, which I didn't call field work then. Because yeah. Pete Seeger did a concert at on campus at Columbia, and I'd heard him once before in Bloomington, Indiana. And that was during a time he was blacklisted and couldn't play on networks, but he did do concerts. I mean, earlier, so I got to hear my banjo hero or see him and hear him in person down in Bloomington. And then this other concert, I remember he said, well, I've just visited Pete Steele, who was a Kentucky banjo player and singer that had been recorded from the Library of Congress. And I was also listening to the Library of Congress recordings that were issued in sets. They had these sets of albums of recordings, you know, from their archives, which is not like today where you can listen to everything and anything, but these were great selections. And, you know, Pete Steele's Coal Creek March and some of the other songs really grabbed me. So when Pete Seeger said that Pete Steele was living and active in Hamilton, Ohio, that wasn't too far from Indianapolis. So a guy who was a high school friend of mine and I, Ed Kahn, later became a folklorist, went to see Pete Steele during those years, and we met him, and I picked up a lot of banjo licks and inspiration mm-hmm. from Pete, and also some old songs his wife Lily Steele sang. But before that, one of my summer jobs was working at a hotel on Lake Michigan, you know, first as a dishwasher and then as a assistant to the chef in the kitchen. In the evenings I go over to migrant farm worker camps seeing if there was any music, and I met some Mexican guys who had acoustic guitars and sang corridos, and I recorded them in a little general store. Then I would go to some camps where there were poor white migrant farm workers who were picking blueberries, same as the Mexicans were, from Missouri and Arkansas and Tennessee, and they knew some of the more recent country songs off the, you know, Hank Williams and stuff like that, but they also played old-time fiddle tunes and sang a range of traditional songs. I'd hang out with them and borrow a tape recorder and record some of what they did. There was one. The first guy I recorded was a guy who had told his fellow workers, and these people were, if you've read The Grapes of Wrath, you know, that would be an accurate picture into the 50s of what these folks were doing. They were staying in these farm camps and driving these rundown cars and following the crops, and they were the nicest people. Just there was one family, the Rhodes family, who lived in a tent. They worked in a smaller farm, and since I didn't have a battery-operated tape recorder, I couldn't record them, but the The father played the banjo and fiddle, and the mother sang several songs, and they had a young kid who I found at the other camp where they did have electricity and recorded him singing a couple of songs, including a modern ballad of the last man that was executed in Missouri, Fred Adams, a modern bad man ballad, modern being from the late 30s. But to get back to Smoky Mountain Cass Moore, you know, he had told his friends, well, I can pick banjo, and he was from the Smoky Mountain area, and he didn't have a banjo with him, so I said, well, you know, they almost didn't believe him, but I had a banjo which I brought the next night, and he pulled, you know, did Shout Lulu and Going Down the Road Feeling Bad and a Rough Branch Blues, sang and played them. Last one didn't have words. And I was making, you know, little recordings on a little mono oral borrowed tape recorder. So because I just wanted to remember and learn the songs. And of course I knew people like Alan Lomax were collectors and, you know, collected music and were, that was the thing. That I was aware of that, but I wasn't thinking of myself as a folklorist or as an archivist. But little by little over the years, I realized that, you know, I have to be maybe a little more mindful of that. And eventually the recordings did make their way into archives and some, and then get issued on LPs first and then other media later. Is that too long? Am I giving too long?
No, that's great.
Too long
an
answer
to
your questions? Because I kind of go on a stream of consciousness.
Yeah,
Try to make it relevant to your question.
That's all excellent. Let's backtrack to Columbia still. When did you meet your wife when you were a student at Columbia, and how did you meet?
No, I didn't. I didn't meet Margot then. Actually, you'd have to sort of fast forward a few years. After I got out of Columbia, I got a loft in downtown Manhattan, mm-hmm. and on Beekman Street, which is a little street that runs from City Hall Park to the East River, where they now have the South Street Seaport, which is very touristy. In those days, it was the Fulton Fish Market, and there were just a couple of good seafood restaurants. And I had a loft and where I could paint and I could afford, because I wasn't really making any money, just giving guitar lessons and maybe occasionally selling artwork, and it was $75 a month for a rather large loft. It was, you know, didn't have hot water or some amenities, but even if you figure in the change, the difference in the economy and the dollar between now and in the early 1960s, that still was affordable. And no young artist can afford a big loft in Lower Manhattan now. Maybe they could if they'd have several million dollars to buy a loft, but otherwise not. But you know, so I painted, had some connections with the art, with fellow artists, but I didn't really get a big exhibition career. I was interested in figurative art, and I'd sort of done some abstract work in graduate school. And about that time, the pendulum was swinging into pop and op and these new things. So I was still, you know, working. But I did then, after a couple of years, get a Fulbright to France to paint. And that was a great year, because that was all I had to do, you know, paint and live in a little place in the 20th arrondissement. Because even then, I couldn't afford a real studio on a Fulbright stipend, but the stipend was fine, you mm-hmm. know. I was still single during that year. Made some friends, some French friends, and some American friends, some of whom I'm still in touch with. And then when I came back to New York, I got another loft. Near on the edge of Little Italy, which an area that's now called Soho, or was called Soho, but it wasn't called that then, south of Houston Street, and there wasn't a big gallery scene. Now the gallery scene's moved on three times, to Chelsea, to the East Village, to Brooklyn, to, but in those days it was like, you know, artists could get lofts because these were like floors of industrial buildings that weren't approved for legal living in most cases, although there was a way you could do that, but that's a long story which I can't go into here. But these had been like light manufacturing or warehouse, that these spaces weren't used, so artists could have working space. And so my second loft was on Broome Street. And during that time, I met Margot, who was from the West Coast, and she'd met at a party. Actually, at that time, I was teaching banjo at the, so the banjo was kind of series of connections, the catalyst for meeting, because I was giving banjo lessons at the Fretted Instruments, which was a branch of the Folklore Center in New York. The Folklore Center was a store that was kind of like the main crossroads of the folk revivals, run by Izzy Young, Israel Young, who is now living in Sweden, and he has a Folklore Center there. But they sold instruments, they sold a folk music book, they let Izzy let a kid from Minnesota play and sing in the back of his store, and Izzy said, "Well, we organize a little program for you. You're really good," and that was Bob Dylan. He was the one who discovered Bob Dylan and sort of got him started. But I'll get back to Bob Dylan in a minute if you want me to. They had a branch called Fretted Instruments, and so I gave banjo lessons through Fretted Instruments, and one of my students worked with Margot as a welfare worker in the South Bronx, and I'd just broken up with one particular girlfriend, and I met Margot at this party, and Margot played the guitar. I was interested in guitar, and she also said she was an artist and studied with Richard Diebenkorn and Elmer Bischoff, some Bay Area figurative painters that I knew and admired. So we got together. So we met in New York City and got married in New York City and had our son Neil, who is runs equipment like this. He's a videographer in Missouri now. But then I got my first teaching job there, and Margot was a painter then, and when she was working for an advanced degree at Iowa, when I was teaching at the University of Iowa, she got interested in photography. So starting in those years, which I guess was in the early 70s, you know, we worked together a lot, you know, because we'd go on trips to record music, meet musicians, and to do the photography, which became an integral part of a lot of the projects that have come out, namely exhibitions, recording issues, and books. So the photographs are really, really important part of that.
Yeah. What was your first collaboration with Margot?
Well, we didn't consider it a collaboration. It's just that once you got into photography, we would, like in Iowa, we'd maybe go out to the fiddlers' picnics, which we kind of got started getting some of the older fiddlers and musicians together. Decided we'd have a gathering at some farm and invite some of the older, old school, I should say, musicians. Some of them were young, like my pal Al Murphy, who was a young fiddler. He just came back from Vietnam, where he'd been in the service, and his uncle had been an old-time fiddler, but he's one of my favorite musical buddies. We did a recording and played a couple of gigs. So we had this fiddler's picnic, and this is just one example, and Margot would be along photographing, so there'd be some pictures. Later, they may end up being a publication. Like the year we left Iowa to come here in '76, We had a big folk festival, this was the bicentennial year, at the University of Iowa, and invited a lot of the people that we knew, fiddle players. There was a gospel singers, the Silver Light Quartet, which was an African-American gospel a cappella group from Cedar Rapids. Jack Bean, who is a self-styled river rat, a great storyteller, and rough singer of river songs. We got all those people there, and so by that time there had been Margaret had been taking photographs all the while, so there was a kind of a little publication that went along with the festival, which organized in conjunction with Harry Oster, who is a folklorist, a very fine folklorist, who was teaching there that we worked with, putting on concerts, and we sort of collaborated doing field work. He'd say, I'll go here and you go there and see who you find. But by the time this publication came out, when we had this folk festival, there were a lot of Margot's photographs in there. So it took a while for these things to coalesce. Oh, another thing. One summer I had a research grant to when I was at the University of Iowa to record and do visual images of Scottish traditional singers, mainly because I'd working with Kenny Goldstein, who is a folklorist. I had learned something about Scottish folk songs. That's going to require going back to New York because I got to know Kenny Goldstein when he found. I guess it'd be okay if I do a little flashback before Iowa, because I think it's important. I did get to know Kenny Goldstein, and he was interested in the fact that I was recording blues players, old school blues players in Indianapolis, and the main person that I recorded that he was interested in was Scrapper Blackwell, and I met Scrapper Blackwell because an African American woman who was helping with my family and doing housework and all, and I asked her about musicians, and she said, there's a man who can play guitar and make blues and Christian songs and make the hair stand on the back of your head. So I went to meet him because I was always curious to meet. I'm basically pretty shy. I heard Iris DeMint interviewed on NPR yesterday, and she said she's a shy person, basically, but that she is so passionate about music that she feels it's up to her to overcome her shyness, I'm paraphrasing her badly, in order to be a performer. So I overcame my shyness in knocking on people's doors or just saying, I hear you play banjo or maybe you know some old songs, as somebody says, or something like that. So anyway, I went to meet this guy, and he was, didn't have a guitar, so I said, well, I'll get a guitar. I said, and he started playing. I said, his friend said, if you want to get the bird to sing, you got to give him some bird seed. I said, what? I was just a college kid. I didn't know I was uneducated. I said, what do you mean? They said, beer. I said, I'm too young to buy beer. They said, you got any money? So I said, yeah, I have a few bucks. I said, we'll get the beer. So they got the beer, and he started playing really, really well. And I recorded him playing some pre-blues and some blues. At that time, I didn't know the name Scrapper Blackwell, you know, if it had been some other names that I heard on records. But my friend, record collector and friend Ted Watts, when I told him a week later, I met this great guitar player, and what's his name? And he talked about making records back in the 20s and 30s. what was his name? Scrapper Black. What? You met Scrapper Blackwell here in Indianapolis? So he was a great blues guitar player. Some people think he's one of the greats, very influential. And his partner, Leroy Carr, was a pianist. And they did the original How Long Blues. And they were kind of the transitional style between the kind of southern styles and a little more sophisticated northern style. But he was really good. And through him, I met several other blues players in Indianapolis. There was a woman named Brooks Berry who never made recordings, who was a really good singer that sang with him. But anyway, Kenny Goldstein said, well, you know these people. This was the summer after I got out of graduate school in 61. Kenny said, record one recording of Scrapper Blackwell, one of him with somebody else, and three other LPs of whoever you want to record. So I did one of Shirley Griffith, this guy from Mississippi who would learn from Tommy Johnson, one of Shirley Griffith and J.T. Adams, who was his friend that he played with and sang with, who was from Kentucky, and one of Guitar Pete Franklin, who was a younger blues player who played piano and guitar and who was sort of a protege of Scrapper's. They were very, very, very good. Scrapper was a little suspicious of, sometimes people ask, well, how did you get established rapport and with folks? And most of the time, people are just interested. If they see you're interested, they're glad to share what they do. And Scrapper was, but when we started making recordings that were going to be issued, which this was pretty much my first experience with that, the other recordings were just ones that I was recording just for the sake of recording them. He would get a couple hundred dollars for a whole album, and back in the early days of the Depression, the A&R men would give him a roll of Leroy Carr a roll of $50 bills before the recording session because their records were selling all over, and here's a whole album, and he thought maybe I must be making some money. He didn't realize that this was for a more limited audience of mostly urban people who were interested in old style blues, the people who were still playing. It was part of the Prestige Bluesville series, and there were a lot of people recording, different artists around the country. Some of the old people who were still active, like Scrapper and Ferry Lewis, and then some people who had not been recorded. But anyway, I was active doing that with Kenny Goldstein. Went back and brought in the recordings and edited, and then I wrote the liner notes on the back of the LP. And I think I got $60 for the liner notes and nothing else. That was all I got for what I put into it. But Scrapper, I don't think he could have. He didn't understand that. But I said I was going to mention something about Bob Dylan. Some of my friends knew him real well in his early days, but I would just hear him play at Gertie's Folk City and in the Village, and just knew him kind of casually. But somehow he found out that I was recording Scrapper Blackwell, so he would buttonhole me and Gertie's, and he'd say, kind of fidgeting around, hey, tell me about Scrapper, man. What's he like? How does he play his guitar licks? What's his personality like? And he wanted to know about Scrapper. Because he thought he was an awesome guitar player. He didn't use that word, but that's what he thought, and he was. So that was pretty much our conversation, and that was when Dylan was just first getting started, because he was absorbing all the music that he could. Whoever would come from. Come into play at Gertie's, whether they be a Canadian folk singer or a blues artist, he would listen, and he'd go back in the kitchen with his guitar and a pad of paper, and he'd catch a little bit of what they were singing, and he would use that as a framework for one of his topical songs that he was writing. Mm-hmm. Who is it said? Bad artists borrow, good artists steal. So he was. Like Blind Willie McTell's Dying Crapshooter Blues, which was his version of the old Unfortunate Rake. He said, I had to steal music from every which way to get it to fit. Because people say, well, that part of that's from St. James Infirmary, part of that's from this old English. So, he would say, so be it. Yeah. During the time I met Kenny Goldstein and was working with him on these blues things, he had also done field work and done a lot of work in Scottish traditional music. He introduced me to Arthur Argo, who was the great-grandson of the Scottish collector Gavin Gregg. And Arthur Argo was a Scottish folk singer, and I met him on his first trip over to the States, and I accompanied him on a record. I was also sort of a ad hoc studio musician playing a little banjo or guitar from different people, including did a little bit with Jean Ritchie on her LP for Folkways Precious Memories, along with Marshall Brickman and Eric Weisberg, a little bit with Bonnie Dobson, a Canadian folk singer, and I did all the accompaniments for Arthur Argo, except for and he sang some songs unaccompanied for a recording of Scottish bawdy songs called A Wee Three to Blue. And there are a lot of great bawdy Scottish folk songs, and they passed the censors in the US in those days because they couldn't have understood the Scottish dialect. But he was saying, how can I take this back to my mother and say, this is the record I made in America? A Wee Three to Blue. Blue means body, and the Scottish singer will say, well, I'll sing that for you, but mind you, it's got a wee three to blue in it, a little thread of blue, blue. Sometimes more than a wee thread. So that was my 10-minute flashback to get the context of going to Scotland for the summer in Iowa. And we met Alex and Belle Stewart, who were travelers, which is a polite word that some people call tinkers, who were itinerant tinsmiths. That's what the tinkers were. And they traveled in the old days in little horse-drawn caravans, and later in cars, and mended pots and pans and did different jobs. And they were kind of, their lifestyle was sort of like the Roma people, the gypsy people, but they were not Roma. They claimed ancestry from Bonnie Prince Charlie and had Scottish names like Stewart and Robertson. And they were great singers of old ballads and pipers and. Since they were itinerant, had more of an oral culture and retained a lot more of the oral culture than the settled Scots. So they carried on a lot of the old Scottish balladry. And Bell and Alex Stewart were already kind of known to collectors, but we met a family called the White family, W-H-Y-T-E. Two sisters, particularly Jean McPhee and Mary Townsley, who were just great singers of the old ballads. And Margot met them, and we were picking raspberries in the berry fields of Blair Gowrie, which was a gathering place for people from all over Scotland, like poorer people, like working class people from Glasgow would go there to get pub money and pick berries and have sing songs and sessions in the camps or in the pubs. And a lot of travelers, and so we met this one particular family and did some recordings with them. They have not, but those recordings, I'd love to issue them someday, but they haven't been issued. And we also, Margot did photography and I did some drawings and paintings, and we never put them together in a cohesive way, the way we did the Georgia projects after we came to Georgia, which I regret, but because it would have made an interesting exhibition or issue, but that was a great experience, meeting people who sang these old songs as just part of their daily life, long songs in great style. And that was one thing we did then.
I guess, so more generally, do you feel that Margot has affected or impacted your own work as a song collector or a folklorist?
Yeah. Sure. Right. Great. Yeah, because we worked together. Because we kind of balance, the modern jargon they call skill sets or certain things that I do. And she, She has actually suggested to the University of Georgia Press, or that we approach University of Georgia Press once we'd collected a lot of material here in Georgia and recorded it and put it up in an exhibition that traveled, first started here at the Image Gallery in, I think, 78, which was Ed and Donna Lambert. Ed taught in the, what was then called the Art Department, now it's Lamar Dodd School of Art, next door to where we are here. They had a gallery, and we put up an exhibition of photographs, drawings, paintings, and featuring the recordings and at times the live performances of people that we were recording. But she said, well, we have all these interviews and audio recordings, maybe we could do it as a book. So we approached the UGA Press and Karen Orchard, who is at the UGA Press, she was our editor, so she was interested in that project. So yeah, it's been we've worked together a lot. You know, she's done photography at some festivals and some events like the National Folk Festival, and we're not always the smoothest team, you know, because we have temperamental and. I think I might have mentioned when we had an earlier conversation that someone asked her in an interview or something, what's like working with me, and she said, holy hell, you know, because we'd have sometimes differences of opinion or also get tired and irritable, but basically we have different skills. She hasn't read any of the books or liner notes that I've written. I write. She says, "Well, I was there." I said, "But don't you want to hear? Don't you want to read how I put this stuff together?" She says, "Well, no, I was there when you recorded. That's good enough." And she might have glanced through it. But I look at her photographs, and we she looks at the drawing. So we compare notes, so that's been I think it's been, you know, a good. Good synergy.
Great. We're going to see if we can move forward a bit. You had said that you two had moved to Athens in 1976, correct?
Yes, right.
Can you describe the Athens music scene when you first moved here?
Well, I guess people find what their interests point them to, and I would imagine that someone who is interested in studying classical music here at the Heinsen School of Music would have told about what the classical musicians were doing and the concerts and the faculty. So what we were interested in was the kind of music that we've been talking to up to this point, you know, traditional music. So the first week we were in Georgia, we were staying in we bought a house in Forest Heights from a guy who was in marine biology. So we went to Sapelo to spend a few days, Sapelo off the Georgia coast, and met some of the people who were storytellers and singers in what's now called the Gullah Geechee culture the first week. And we also went up to the Mountain Fair in Hiawassee. And started meeting some of the mountain musicians, which led to meeting other mountain musicians. And then to get back to Athens, Bill Giles, who is a young guitar player whose father was the director of the Athens Airport, Ben Epsfield. He was an enthusiastic guitar player. Somehow he knew that I was interested in that music, so he said, you should meet Doc Barnes, who's an older guy, African-American guy who plays finger-picking old-style guitar. So I met Doc Barnes and his wife, Lucy, who, you know, we became really good friends with them, and they introduced us to a lot of other singers of religious music, old style and other styles too, and other people who played guitar and some who did non-religious music like blues, like Neil Patman, a guy named Willie Hill in East Athens. So here I am talking about a lot of these people who would not be known to the greater Athens community. They'd be known in the African-American community. We met Jim Wills, who was a white guy that worked with Doc in the cotton mills, who played, and they were musical friends, which speaks to the cross-pollination of white and black traditions in Southern music, which is a whole other huge subject. But they were friends, and so I met them. Then I met the Tanners, actually Gordon Tanner, who was the son of Gid Tanner, who formed the first and continuing to this day country music group. And you know, in the 20s, starting in 1924, it was Gid Tanner's Skillet Lickers, one of the great string bands that made recordings up to 34 as the original group. I didn't know Gordon Tanner had played lead fiddle in the Skillet Lickers' last session in 34 when the fiddlers, Lowe Stokes and Clayton McMitchin, had left the group and the group was reconstituted. But I'd heard those recordings in the Indianapolis Public Library in an anthology put together by Alan Lomax, Ida Red. And here I was meeting Gordon Tanner and hearing him play. He played up at the Mountain Music Festival. And then I started going out to Tequila in Gwinnett County, where they then and still have Friday night sessions. So I got to meet these other musicians in the environment. So that was who I was attracted to. As far as what a lot of people understand as the Athens music scene, the rock scene, there probably were some early rock bands, but that didn't burst onto the scene until just a few years after we came here. A lot of it was kind of in the milieu of the art school or art then the art department, because some of the, for example, Michael Stipe, who is the frontman of REM, was an art student, and he was in a couple of classes of mine, and he formed this band that was a local band that became, that was not known beyond the locality until they catapulted into the big time in a matter of a couple of years and were nationally known and appreciated. And there were other bands too, like Pylon. A lot of those guys were art students, late Randy Bewley and Curtis Crow. And no, they were, yeah, were they in Pylon? Yes, I think so. And then there was Love Tractor, which was another band. But a lot of those folks were art students, were in the art department, were artists. Michael Lahusky was in Pylon, and he currently works near here at the Georgia Museum of Art. Last year, there was a kind of a revival of the interest in those years and in the form of an exhibition and some events. But that became what was known as Athens music scene that people would have heard of other places, and that spawned a lot of other bands, and that's what put Athens on the map in that context, the context of music forms that are known beyond the region, you know, like through the music industry or tours and all that. And my interest was in local musicians, like Neil Patman went on to, you know, go to Germany and Canada and late in life. But when I met him, he basically had played in juke joints and fish fries, and he's a one-armed guy. He lost an arm in a farm accident up in Nice, Georgia, where he grew, where he was grew up on a farm. He was a terrific blues harp player, harmonica player. For those who don't know the term harp or French harp, and he became an influence on some of the musicians when he started playing for wider audiences. But some of these folks who played music within their community. So that was, you know, I was a little to the side of that. We started organizing things. We had a festival at Reed Quadrangle on campus just a couple years after got here, and there was a square dance. They got a caller, got the Eller brothers from Hiawassee, who are these old-time musicians to play guitar and old-style two-finger banjo and sang. And I can't remember if Neil Patman was at that event. That was a precursor of the North Georgia Folk Festival, which the Athens Folk Music and Dance Society started in subsequent years. And I think this year, if it hadn't gotten rained out, we're hoping to reschedule, would be the 31st year of that festival. So that brought some of the younger groups who were playing more modern adaptations of folk music and singer-songwriters together with some of these old folks who grew up in traditional music venues. So there became more interaction. It's kind of complicated because there's so many different types of music and tastes. Remember when I first knew Michael Stipe, and he was in my Aqueous Media class, and he claimed he wasn't good at drawing, but he had a great eye and was a good photographer and was always very interested in visual arts and very very tightly wired and intense and extraordinary artistic personality, and could tell that even when he was at a young age. But I asked him once, you might be interested in this, Kevin. I asked, because of knowing the history of rock and roll and rhythm and blues and all that. And I said, are you interested in the early history of rock and roll and how it came out of rhythm and blues? Now that came from blues and, this kind of stuff that's still to be. And he said he wasn't interested at all in that. He wants to be an artist living in the present tense, and his idol was Andy Warhol and the kind of scene. They wanted to, creativity came out of not delving into a history, even if it was there. I'm extrapolating a lot. He didn't articulate all these things, but he just said he wasn't interested in the roots of rock and roll in that respect. And that changed because Brant Slay, who was one of the two members of the Chickasaw Mud Puppies, the other being Ben Reynolds, who is currently teaching photography at Lamar Dodd School of Art, they did what they called swamp rock, and they were interested in where the music came out of. They did their own kind of take on earlier music. But I think it was Brant who played some recordings of Cecil Barfield, who was a George Mitchell did extensive recordings of him, and I did some. But he was a rural blues guitar player, African American player in South Georgia, who was a fantastic singer and guitar player of a very, very early style. And Michael somehow heard those recordings and wanted, and that kind of changed his stance toward at least toward part of the older tradition. He really wanted to meet Cecil Barfield, and we said, well, we tried to organize a trip where we'd go down and see him, but it didn't work out. But he did, he became interested. So there were all those, there were, you know, some of the Athens rock people yeah. were interested in the older roots, and others, you know, had a different points of departure, but that's the way artists work. You know, it's hard to generalize. Another factor that came in that was Howard Finster, and this next month, December 2015 will be the centenary of his birth. He died, I don't know how many years ago, maybe, might be 20 years ago now. And he was a self-taught artist and Baptist preacher from Northwest Georgia who created the famous Paradise Gardens. And he might be maybe the most, he's been called the Picasso of the folk artists. So he was just extraordinary, did this 3-acre environment, found objects and sculptures and started doing paintings, and he was also a musician. He played banjo, played five-string banjo, and he did some old religious songs and some non-religious songs that he learned as a kid in Alabama. And one of my colleagues, Andy Nassis, and I taught a course in the art department called Aspects of Folk Culture, where we would go and visit people like the White County Mossy Creek potter, Lanier Metters, who was the foremost maker of face jugs. We'd visit people like W. Guy Bruce, who was in Finster's area in North Georgia, who was an old-time banjo player and singer. And we'd visit Howard Finster. And we brought Howard Finster for a couple of concerts here on the University of Georgia campus. And I think the second one was at, no, I th- the first one was at the campus, second one was at the Botanical Gardens. I think that's the one that Michael Stipe attended because he wanted to see what all the fuss was about, because here his art professors were talking about this interesting guy, Reverend Howard Finster. And I think he was a little skeptical, of what interest would this eccentric retired preacher be? But his mind was completely blown by the slideshow and Howard's talking and playing and the whole thing. And they went up to visit him, and I think it did something with one of the REM's early recordings. So they got really, really interested in Howard Finster's work. So that was another kind of input that not only Howard Finster, but Dilmus Hall, who is an African-American self-taught artist who lived here in Athens. And those of you who visited our home, you might have seen a painting that I did of Dilmus Hall in the large painting of him standing in front of some of his large concrete sculptures of the devil throwing a rock at a drunken man. And the man was really a brilliant and interesting artist, and now he's in museums and also very articulate. I remember Michael Stipe and some other friends went to his 89th birthday party. Neighbor brought some cake or something over at his house on Deering Extension. So there was an interest in that aspect of the crossover, the visual and the music.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think that's a good stopping point for today.
Is that a stopping point for today?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I did most of the talking. Is that right? Is that what you wanted?
that's fantastic.
Because I didn't let you get into more questions.
Yeah, that's all right. But thank you again so much for being here today and talking with us.
It was my pleasure. You know, it brings back a lot of memories, it's good to try to sort out some of the things that we've been talking about. I really appreciate the interest, and you all who are going to see this in some form in the future, I hope you can make some sense of my ramblings.
And we'll continue talking on next Tuesday, too.
Okay, so we'll...
Great.
I'll try to think of something I didn't say today. Just, all right, I know you'll have some questions.
Yeah. So thank you again.
You're welcome.